Wow, do we have a lot to get to in this video. Good Lord. So, first of all, we, in the mood of repentance, realizing that we have this next step, we have to go big, and this is going to be, of course, it's a struggle. Going big, you put your attention on it, your focus on it. You know you're just going to produce a wow feeling, and you say, okay, I'll pay the price. Let's go. Let's do it. I have to do it. And what's the definition of love? Well, for me, it would be, you know, in friendship, sharing with your friends whatever knowledge you have about what is wonderful, what is precious. And use just prosaic examples. You know, you have this restaurant, the food's just great there. I mean, we know some places where the food is great. Anyway, you tell your friends, you say, hey, if you want really good food, you know, this is the place to go. You share with your friends what you found out to be wonderful and precious, and you say, hey, I think this will make you, you know, this will make you really happy if you go there. So you want your friends to be happy. You tell them what you know about happiness. I mean, what else could love be? I mean, it's the sharing of that, and you don't hold it to yourself, say, oh, I know a great place, I'm not going to tell anybody, like that. You know, that wouldn't be love. So love is the sharing of information, the good news, the sharing of what it, you know, you find out, well, like a wonderful golf course, for instance. You say, hey, I know this really wonderful golf course, and let's say it really is, and it's way better than the other ones, you know, and you tell your friends, hey, you should check this place out. I mean, someone did that to me. They said, hey, there's this course, and you think this one's nice, this other one's way better, you're really going to like it. And they kept pestering me, saying, you're really going to like it, you got to try it. Finally, I didn't believe them at first at all. I said, no, they're just trying to brag or something. But they kept going on and on about, I think you're really going to like this place. And so I one day I finally decided, let me check it out. I still was very skeptical. Well, it turned out to be exactly what they said and more. And I had a run there of about 8 years. It was just glorious, absolutely glorious. Escape from the world. And they, you know, they shared with me. For some reason, they were loving people. They said, hey, this, we like him. He's like a friend to us. Let us tell him and share the good news about a place that's really, really, really peaceful and beautiful and nice. Okay, that's loving, right? Being loving is you give what is good to others. You tell them about it. So in my instance, how do I be loving? Well, I received an invitation to the dwelling place of Jesus. You may call it the death-free realm. I don't know exactly how it's going to be, but I can tell you it's a very precious invite indeed. So what I'm sharing with others is, how is it that I got this invite? I want others to go there. I mean, I've had experiences of finding places that are extraordinarily beautiful in this world, way better than almost anything else. And what do? I tell people about it. And characteristically, nobody pays any attention. They just don't believe me. Yeah, it's amazing. It's very frustrating. And you have to keep telling him, pestering him. And when they finally go, they're shocked. They say, oh my gosh, I can't believe it. But nobody goes. But anyway, imagine the most wonderful party in the world. I mean, this one is the top of the top of the top of the top of the A-list. Everybody's trying to go to this party and get an invitation. Invitation only. People are frantically struggling, calling all their connections. Hey, do you have a lead? Do you have an invite? No. Do you have a lead? Well, no, I heard I might know somebody, a friend of a friend of a friend says they might know somebody, you know, and, well, can you help me out and get this invite? And so people are frantically networking and saying, well, what's it going to cost? Who do I bribe? You know, who do I seduce? There's all different ways that people get invitations, they think, to this party. They want to get a ticket to the party. So let's say somebody has a ticket, and they see all these other people want, and they say, hey, yeah, I got a ticket. And other people say, well, how did you get this ticket? How did you get it? I mean, what connections do you have to get this ticket? We want to know, because we want to attend this party. It's very important. Now, so I have an invitation from Jesus. This is the ticket, the most prized ticket there is. Nothing comes even close. Okay. I have that ticket. I have the invitation from Jesus himself directly. And so I want everybody to be there. I want everybody to be there, because I know, here's an example. On a beautiful golf course, you're out there and there's all these people playing the course, and you might think, well, you know, maybe there's my enemy over there. You know, you're wondering, like, how are people going to treat me? What do they think? You don't worry about it. When you're on a really beautiful golf course, everybody's your friend, and you're everybody's friend. And this is true. I mean, I don't worry about, am I going to be accepted? People going to like me? Everybody's going to like you. Why? Because they're happy. They're fulfilled. They're getting what they want. They're not feeling a sense of lack so much. Then you know you're not going to play so good, but it doesn't matter. It's beautiful palm trees and flowers and luscious grass and just gorgeous. Everybody's your friend, and you're everybody else's friend. And afterwards, you complete strangers. You talk with them, and you go afterwards, and you might have a bite to eat together, and you see each other, you wave, because you're getting what you want. You're fulfilled. So in the kingdom of heaven, in paradise, in the death-free realm, everybody's your friend. Everybody's fulfilled. See, so you want everybody to come there. I want everybody to come there. I want everybody. So I want to tell everybody, here's how I got the invitation. You can get one too. Now, how did I get the invitation? Well, it's pretty simple. First thing that people will look at is they say, well, okay, who did he bribe? Who did he know? Who did he influence? Here's the thing that not that it's causative, but this is the picture. What is really causative is just relentless, determined, focused work on clarifying the truth, clarifying what is true. This is the ticket, plain and simple. And so I spent every moment of my life with this focus, ignoring everything else and not giving it my full attention, for sure. So my full attention was on clarifying truth. And it never stopped. It's always this way. That's how you get the ticket. Now, because of this, not putting my attention, full attention on other things, I've fallen to the lowest of the lowest realms of social status in this world. I don't have any friends. I don't have any network at all that I can rely upon. I don't have any connections. I don't have any work now, hardly at all. I don't have ways and means. I don't have, I'm just, and my job is just the lowest of the lowest type of job. I've just completely fallen through the cracks down into the lowest strata who can I call upon when I have trouble? Nobody, really. Not unless you're talking about just immediate family, and even that sometimes is divided, you know. And I don't have any money I can fall back upon. Don't have any, you know, status. I don't even have, even like being a white male, nobody feels any sorry or pity for you. So you don't have this, you know, minority status you can rely upon. I don't, you know, you're the last in line for that, you know, for largesse and all that. I don't want to rely on the government and get into that. It's just I am absolutely not connected as far as influence goes, in the slightest way. So I don't have any influence at all. I don't know anybody, you know, that can get me a ticket. So it's 100% the work of clarification that got me the invitation. Nothing else. Nothing else is involved at all. So this should be a story, a teaching story to everybody. Not that if you do have friends and all this, not that that precludes you from getting a ticket at all. However, you have to have a single-minded focus on clarifying truth. That's how you get the ticket. So, and by doing so, of course, you're not going to give much attention to friends or anything else. You just don't have the time or the focus or inclination to do so. And all I want to do is I want to share with people the good news. Like, wow, we really can get a ticket to this, you know, great situation. So there is the beginning salvo of the video, and it's very important. Who you know doesn't matter at all. Okay, it's not like I can say to Jesus, well, they're my friends, so can you let them in? No, because in order to get into the kingdom in the death-free realm, paradise realm, I presume this is Jesus' dwelling place, your mind cannot panic. When you're there, Now, you could go there, and but your mind after a little while would start panicking if you're not prepared properly. If you're confused ideologically, confused belief system is confused. You haven't clarified, you know, and detached from the egoic belief system. You're going to start panicking, and then that's going to drive you into more fear. So, you wouldn't stay there anyway. You would become unpleasant for you for sure. You say, wait a minute, where's all the death? You know, God's going to be really angry at me. I took a vacation from death. He's going to be furious. He's going to, his righteous, just anger and his justice will demand my severe punishment. Oh my gosh, this is horrible. This is with the panic that happens. Because we're so focused on believing that we have to die. We're pretend to die and sell this to guilt, to this imaginary God judge we've imagined and made up out of our own imagination. That if we take even an instant off from focusing on trying to pretend to be dead, we imagine that this God judge is we've somehow crossed the justice, we've sinned against this God, and we've broken his laws, we're transgressors, and therefore we deserve the punishment that the justice demands. And this is a God of absolute justice and laws and justice, and if you break those laws, the punishment is inexorable. God cannot deviate in the slightest bit from punishing us exactly as is justified under the transgressions that we made. This is our belief in this imaginary God that we've imagined, who is simply there in our imagination to supposedly judge our death, so that then judge that therefore we can now be resurrected. We imagine we've empowered some imaginary God with this capability, which so that when we die and judge that we're dead, that means God also died, since we're one with the true God. That means we brought about the death of God. That's what we're really up to. Very important distinction here, which is how I got the ticket to from Jesus. Really, you have to be able to make this clarification. Not an easy clarification to make in this madhouse here, to say the least. So if you take time off from pretending to be dead, which is what we believe this God of guilt is demanding of us, then this is an extreme transgression against this God, which then would result in just tremendous punishment for us. And so we become panicky and have to figure out, well, how do I bribe this God, you know, to not punish me so severely? And of course, we have a whole system of bribery and sacrificial atonement, you know, Helestrian, Greek term, meaning propitiating this angry God, which is an ancient pagan ceremony. The ancient pagans used to sacrifice their firstborn. Human sacrifice was very prevalent in ancient times, where the firstborn they would sacrifice these firstborn men, and in some instances even eat them, to show that God, this God, that they were truly dedicated to death as this God demanded. And then this turned into sacrificing the firstborn of animals in the spring. The rite of Passover, Jewish Passover, really came from that. And it also, the idea of putting blood, you know, to avoid the wrath of God. Well, keep in mind that throughout history, we've had many plagues of many different types, disasters that wipe out, you know, so many people, just devastation. And they felt that putting the blood there prevented that, propitiated it. And we can go into that ancient mindset, but that's a little bit, digressing a little bit. But it's easy to digress. So we just have to say, okay, let's not get into that too much. But to clarify this nonsense, see, we feel we're going to be punished if we go to paradise because we've taken our attention off of death. Nothing there is dying. We forget all about it. Oh, this is wonderful. I like this better. And say, uh-oh, God found out that I like life better than death. This is terrible. You know, what can I do? How can I make amends? Oh, my gosh. I mean, I'm going to have to go to the sacrificers and say, you know, this is my sin, my transgression. I went to paradise and I forgot all about death. They say, oh, my gosh, well, you're going to have to pay us a large amount of money and we're going to have to do all this sacrifice of animals for you. We'll make prayers at the temple or wherever, you know, the altar and to prevent God's wrath from smiting you and from smiting everybody in the community and in the nation, you know, and this kind of stuff. So there's this enormous taboo against that. enormous taboo. That's why people are so frightened to go someplace where it's really beautiful. And what I find is, even in this world, there are some beautiful places. It gives the illusion that it's not touched by death so much. Only the people feel only those who are really wealthy can go there. Why? Because they have the money to pay God to propitiate. You know, they say, oh, well, they can bribe God into not being so angry and pay for their transgressions. You know, maybe they forgot about death for a little while. But they're right back at it soon. Whereas we feel, oh, gosh, I don't have any way to bribe God. For me, I don't have any way to bribe God. I don't have possessions. I don't have money. I don't have anything to bribe God with, really. So it's like, how do I dare go to such places, right? How do I dare? People are very nervous. So we're under this extraordinary fear, which is all based on our desire to be greater than God. And we came up with a scheme of how to do this, and now we're supposedly trapped in this scheme. And have been so, and religion is, I mean, the whole idea of Jesus being a sacrificial atonement, what is believed by what I call Old Testament Christians, propitiatory Christians, Hilasterian Christians, Greek word meaning propitiate, to appease, is that we had sinned against God so severely that God's wrath was just absolutely extreme, demanding the most hideous, eternal punishment for us, eternal punishment and torture for us. And that God felt so sorry for us that he couldn't do anything. He couldn't stop the punishment. It was justified. And the idea is that God is some God of justice and laws and cannot, you know, the punishment has to come. That God said, what do I do? I mean, it's terrible. I have to destroy all these souls eternally, destroy them. But I'm a God of quote-unquote love, so what can I do? I'll send my only son, my firstborn and only son, to suffer all the wrath instead. So the idea is that Jesus in the Passion had all the extreme wrath of God that was due every one of us for all our sins and transgressions. What's a transgression? Thinking like, hey, you know what? I really don't like dying. I don't like pretending to be dead. I'd rather have eternal life. That's the ultimate transgression. So we're constantly having to try to appease this imaginary God, like that, oh, we're really into death, God, we're really into dying, we're really into sickness, yeah, we're really into this hard scrabble life of being a human being, we're really into this, you know, we're pretending to believe in death, that we love it. If we know anything less than that is a transgression. So the idea was that all of the God's extreme wrath from that had to be generated from the breaking of these laws, that God had no way to stop this wrath, that it was automatically generated from the breaking of these laws. All of that was poured out on Jesus, so he suffered just this, you know, incredible, ferocious wrath of God, and suffered so hideously and unbelievably hideously for us. And that once God had then finished the punishment, then that balanced the books. Okay, so the punishment had been meted out, and therefore then we were free of any punishment for our past transgressions, like that. And then they also said, well, but you know, somehow God then punished us for all our future transgressions as well on Jesus. So all we have to do is believe Jesus is the sacrificial atonement. Not only are all our past transgressions paid for, but all our future ones are also. So that's a kind of neat little thing here, where you just believe that Jesus was the sacrificial atonement, and that you're somehow saved from God's wrath, you know, like that. Okay, saved by the grace of God, as they say. Now, this has been the prevailing teaching of Judeo-Christianity. Now, the Jews went from sacrificing their firstborn humans to sacrificing animals. Okay, this was a big step forward. Say, wait a minute, you know, they said, God told us that we don't have to sacrifice the firstborn anymore if we are dedicated to trusting and believing and serving this God. You know, they sort of make a deal. We made a deal here, kind of thing. And eventually they went to, the temple sacrifice and collecting a lot of money from burnt offerings to God and stuff. And I pointed out that this all might be actually ultimately work in the favor of truth by giving us time to actually start contemplating that the laws and stuff cause us to stop acting on impulse so much. So instead of, like Abraham, was bringing Isaac to sacrifice his firstborn to God because that's what he felt God demanded. And then the angel of the Lord stopped his hand, before he's going to bring the dagger down and said, look, there's a ram caught in a thorn thicket there. You sacrifice that instead. So it's sort of like the Holy Spirit, angel of the Lord, Holy Spirit said, hey, wait a minute, hey, let's start moving away from this whole ideology, okay, of insanity. And so this was the notion of the covenant of the Jews was really with the Holy Spirit, which is God the Holy Spirit, which says, let's start moving away from this hideous belief in this hideous God that demands his hideous laws, demand hideous punishment. And so the Jews became very, very focused on trying to get around the law. Here's the laws, but here's a way to get around it. If you get around it this way, then you can do this. And trying to move away from just the pagan, just impulsive, oh, firstborn, okay. So let's slaughter the firstborn right now. And just, real proactive type of thing. And ultimately, Jesus brought even a stronger way of moving away from this. Certainly, if you feel that all your sins are forgiven because Jesus paid the price for them, then you might start spending some time saying, okay, now what do I do now? I don't have to worry about sacrifice or anything. So maybe I can start thinking about truth and clarifying it, right? So you could look at it in this way, actually. I mean, it's not like you have to condemn it all, even though some it appears to be absolute madness. As I've said, that Jesus actually accommodated us, our script, it needed to accommodate us because otherwise we'd reject, it'd be too much for us, we'd freak out. So he said, okay, I'll accommodate your script of sacrificial atonement and paying for the price. Oh, okay, it's okay, you can believe in that for a while, I'll accommodate that. But in the meantime, use this grace period that you have, like, oh, I'm not so afraid of God's going to attack and punish me because Jesus showed eternal fealty to death, to God. And so God said, oh, I'm so happy, my only son was obedient even unto death, so I'm not angry anymore, and all my anger has been expiated, and it's gone. So we feel, oh, we have a grace period, we just claim the life of Jesus, the atonement of Jesus, and then God will say, oh, okay, you're okay, because you believe that my son really did die. So as long as you believe that, God says, I'll give you a pass. So maybe this gave people an opportunity to start actually thinking about everything, and considering it, instead of just impulsively reacting to the demands of ultimately the ego, this God, this angry Jehovah, sacrificial God, is just the ego. It's just the voice of arrogance in us. It's just the advice on how to try to accomplish the impossible that we're giving ourselves. And of course, we can't accomplish the impossible. So this advice is just utterly derelict, completely derelict. So there, you can put a silver lining on it, okay? It's not like you have to, don't condemn yourself. Put a silver lining on it. Flip the script. Yeah, those who believe in Jesus as a sacrificial atonement, they say, hey, I don't have to worry about God punishing me anymore, about focusing on death, because Jesus did that for me. But of course, that still leaves a lot of questions unanswered, doesn't it? But it does buy time to actually start considering it without so much fear. So it took a lot of fear out of people, right? Even though it's complete nonsense, it still took fear out of people. And that's a positive. So, the Holy Spirit works in mysterious ways. And we have to have a positive, glasses half full outlook towards the situation. But it's a start. It's a start. It's not a finish. It's a start. It's sort of like buying some time to give it some consideration. But if you don't do any consideration, you know, then it's not really, you're still stuck with, you know, the total madness of your, of this dream. And you haven't untangled it. So, but using this last couple thousand years has been very helpful for me. So Christianity has actually helped me, because if you look at pagan times, the people were extraordinarily impulsive. And they just killed. Attack. There was very little in between the outrage and the attack. And outrage could be anything. Just, you have what I want, therefore I attack. Look at the, like, Egypt, and like, Ptolemy in Egypt, the Greek rulers, the Ptolemy rulers of Egypt from about 330 BC to 30 BC, when Cleopatra was finally deposed by, who was it, Octavian or something like that. That we have a very detailed history of that time, which is why we can look at it. And the Greeks wrote a lot and were meticulous about history. And the Ptolemies married within the family, brother and sister kind of thing. And there was joint rulers, pretty male and female, because brother and sister, they often ruled jointly. And the battles between the royal families, within the royal families, of everybody just killing one another and deposing one another, is just crazy. It's just crazy. We have a history of it. So, I mean, the Ptolemaic history of Egypt, 300 years or so, is very interesting to read, because that gives you a very accurate picture of what the ancient world was like. You know, the mothers would kill their son, or kill their husband, or kill their brother, such and such would kill that. I mean, it was both men and women were absolutely impulsive and scheming and killing one another and deposing one another and just fighting. And this was what the ancient world was all about. And you had a lifespan. Well, you can't rely upon when they factor in infant mortality and disease and all this kind of stuff, the lifespan, you know, but if you made it into adulthood as a strong adult, etc., then you could live. I mean, some people live to into their 80s and such. But they say, well, the average lifespan was 25 years. Well, that's ridiculous, because they were counting all the infant mortality in that sort of statistic. But, you know, there's a rough and tumble life. And everybody was extraordinarily scheming and impulsive. And how do you spend a lifetime free of fear under such circumstances? I mean, there were just constant wars, constant battles, constant insurrections. We know this from the history, very detailed history. The Jews also kept detailed histories. Combination of the Jews and the Greeks gave us a history of the world, very, very strong detailed history. And we know what it was like. And yet, you know, you look at right now, in the world right now, living this, like for me, just this idyllic suburban existence where nothing's happening at all. There's no threat at all. I've been able to dedicate my entire life to contemplation and clarity, which in the ancient times was just be almost, you know, unheard of. So there's something to be said about Christian civilization and civilization in general in different ways, where the people takes the fear out. You have to take the fear out of society in some way. Otherwise, that fear is constantly impulsing us to attack, defend, accuse. And you can't do the type of clear contemplation that you need to do with that kind of mindset. It's getting very difficult now in the world, because people are getting very uncivil right now. Very uncivil, all sides. Very contemptuous, arrogant, uppity, uncivil, attack mode. So, but fortunately, I already did the work during a very wonderful time where I was able to, you know, just, I'll look back at it in hindsight very fondly, I'm sure. So this is a tribute. I mean, this is a Judeo-Christian culture in America, and it did bring about a certain level of security here. And people minded their own business. They were polite to one another, very, very civil. They were not impulsive, you know, forgiving. We'll overlook that, and we trust you, we believe in you, appeal to the highest nature, that kind of culture. And so I responded to that very, very well. People said, well, look, even though you might be messing up this way, we feel that you're a solid, very good citizen. And so people have this basic, they looked at the culture I grew up in, you were looked at as, you're a good person, you're an intelligent person, you're a good person, you're a worthwhile person, you're a trustworthy person. And everybody expected this of you, and so you this became part of your character, you know. So, you know, the idea of, like, if there's like you find a wallet somewhere, you know, and it's you know, loaded with credit cards and money, you don't even, there's not even a question of returning that just exactly what it was. There's never a question of stealing anything from anybody, taking what doesn't belong to you. There's never, so all those, you know, Ten Commandments and the Bible, Judeo-Christian heritage. It's like it gets ingrained within you. And so that makes for a more peaceful life, okay? And people trust one another, and which is very, very important. It's not like you're under surveillance all the time, where you're supposed to be self-governing. Like the game of golf, you're supposed to call penalties on yourself. Everybody trusts you. They don't police you, and you police yourself. You know, so there's a culture of self-policing that we had. Now we have this hideous technocracy, which is basically saying nobody can be trusted. That's really what technocracy is nobody can trust it. The culture I grew up in, everybody can be trusted. We trusted everyone implicitly. We never locked our cars, never locked our house. Windows open. We never gave it a second thought. You go out somewhere, you trust everybody. You're not in fear. Like you go shopping, you go traveling somewhere. You're not in fear. You say you feel that the people are also Judeo-Christian heritage or some other noble heritage, and they're trustworthy. Now, unfortunately, that is no longer the case, which is by design. It's the collapse of civilization here. Civilization means you trust one another. Okay, if you don't have that sort of culture, you have a negative, fear-based culture just going toward impulsiveness. Now you have women, you know, beating each other up ferociously. I think there's some female boxing match or mixed martial arts or something just happened, and there's some, it's everywhere, you know, in the news, in the media, and it's like everybody's talking about it, like, oh, this is like awesome, some woman just destroyed another woman, you know. This is hideous. This is absolutely obscene. You know, the women are the heart and soul of the civilization, and the trustworthiness that women had. For instance, we could go to any house, you know, we could knock on any door. Growing up in the 50s, 60s, 70s in America, you could knock on any door and say, Mrs. So-and-so, you know, I'm thirsty. Oh, come on in, sure. What do you need? Here, have all my food. Let me make some food for you, okay? Everybody looked out after you, one another, and you felt like, you're free to go anywhere. You're not worried about anything. You ride your bike anywhere, and the women looked out for you. It doesn't matter whether your child or someone else's child. They looked out for you. The culture looked out for you. They trusted you. Come into my house. You're not going to steal anything. I'm not even thinking about that. You know, and if in the transgressions, you know, we were admonished and then forgiven, because they said, we know you're better than that, and we absolutely believe it. We know it. And so when you grow up in a culture where everybody looks at you and says, we know you are a really great spirit, and we love you, we're so glad that you're here, and we know you're going to do great things, there's no question in our mind whatsoever. When you are absolutely surrounded by that, this is just makes the difference. It makes the difference. Okay. And where the media highlights goodness. You know, people start believing in goodness. They believe they can trust one another, generosity, all this. When you grow up, and this is what's highlighted, people act that way then. They say, this is the norm. This is the norm. It's very powerful. Culture is a very powerful tool, actually. So I grew up in a great culture. There's no question about it. And even like, you know, like I'm out on a golf course and I managed to scrape, borrow or charge or scrape together enough money to be out there. And then it's like I have nothing left. And I have no position in the world. And yet I have a nice, I have a cap on, you know, and I have a shirt. Okay. I'm out on the golf course. And here come these guys. They're obviously like CEOs. They're, you know, billionaires or something. I mean, they're, you know, you can just tell. And they, hey, how you doing? Can we mind if we play through? Oh, sure. Yeah, no problem. Thanks a lot. You know, and how's it going? And everybody just trusted me. You know, everybody just trusts me because I'm part of the culture. And so they, you know, I say, wow, I'm completely free here. I can do whatever I want to do. Nobody's going to say anything. Nobody's, the marshal's not looking at me. No, people are spying on me. But no, I can do whatever I want to do. If I want to, you know, zigzag over this way or go over that, it's okay. Nobody's, you know, said this guy, you know, we trust him. You're on the honor system. And so that empowers you. When you feel that people feel that you're honorable, you're going to act honorably. But you're going to give yourself from leeway. And they say that's okay. You know, as long as you... You know, we trust that your life, you're honorable in your own life, you see. And this is the culture that is being attacked, under attack right now by the architects of destruction in high places in this world. And they're, you know, they're attacking every which way they can attack this culture, they are doing so. They're going after the police because the police are easy targets, aren't they? Because they have to deal in very tough ways with extraordinarily vicious thuggery and criminals, and so they're trying to hold them up as symbolic of this culture, and then going after them, attacking them. It's an easy target. You know, this is very vicious. This is the architecture of destruction to pave the way for a vicious technocracy that is spying on everybody and believes that everybody's evil, everybody's vicious, nobody's honorable, everybody has to be monitored constantly. This works against you, okay? In terms of getting that ticket to paradise I'm talking about, this works against you to an extraordinary extent. So I really have my culture to thank, you know, for getting that ticket in a lot of ways. I couldn't have made it without them. And this is the white Judeo-Christian culture of America. Let's be quite clear about that, along with other ethnic groups too that also acted in this way coming here. But it was founded by white Judeo-Christian ethics, which feel that you are honorable. You don't have to prove your honor to me. It's a given. You have to disprove it, and you have to do a lot to disprove it. And even if you do a lot to disprove it, I'm still going to believe in your essential goodness. And of course, Judeo-Christianity says, I know you're saved, that Jesus saved you. If you just believe in it, you're saved. Now, this was, of course, just a formula of sacrificial atonement, which isn't really true at all. There is no such wrathful God, but it did have a silver lining to it. So you are an honorable person. And even, you know, we even treat, you know, homeless people, and we treat even criminals. I mean, Christians give asylum to criminals, and say, so, you know, you're still an honorable person in my eyes. Whatever you've done, you cannot debase yourself in my eyes. And people respond to this. You see, really. And I try to be that way, no matter who the person is, no matter how far they've fallen. I say, you know, it doesn't matter. You still are your person of honor, and you've got to police yourself and act in an honorable way. And now, it's not that we act perfectly. We might take license with it in various ways, and most do. But then you bounce back and say, hey, you know, let me. You know, I have to maintain my dignity and my honor and police my own life. And so we're self-governed. We're largely, the idea of America is a self-governance to a large extent. Now we have this hideous rise of technocracy and massive bureaucracy and leaders who don't trust the people at all. And they want to monitor everything. It's the opposite of what America was founded. America was founded on self-governance. We trust you. We trust ourselves. We trust you. We know you're going to do the right thing, okay? And by and large, you know, we did in many, many ways. Small town America. You go into a grocery store, there's nobody there, maybe somebody in the back listening to a ball game, and, you know, you go shopping, you get the stuff you want, and, I mean, someone might just say, hey, just put the money on the counter, you know? And so you just figure, how much is this worth? Oh, okay, and put the money on the counter. Or I say, I don't have enough. Oh, just pay me next time. Okay. All right, it's never a thought. I mean, And I've had that situation, different people from different cultures, like Vietnam, for instance, they, honorable people. I said, oh, I don't have any money for the food. They said, oh, don't worry, pay me next time. You'll take care of it some other time. That's all right. There's, of course, there's honorable, very honorable people and cultures all over the world. But in America, the idea was that we're going to be self-governing as possible here. We're going to emphasize this, and we did. But this was all turned around by fear, okay? And fear through many, many channels. The media highlighting crime and the shows on television highlighting the worst of human nature. They're trying to contract us into believing that we can't trust one another. And this is a very, very nasty and hideous antichrist situation. So the whole Jesus situation gave us some breathing room, and it was very effective. Now all I'm saying is taking the next step, which is even a higher step, okay, taking a higher step, where Jesus came to me and said, look, I trust you so much, I'm inviting you to my home. That's what Jesus said. I trust, my trust in you is so perfect. I know, you know, you can govern, you can act so properly that I am going to invite you to my home. You know, that shows you, you know, just how the next big step. Not that I'm perfect or good in every way, but the idea is that that Jesus says, you know what, but I trust that you're going to recognize what you need to recognize. And you're disciplined, you're willing, you're disciplined, you have the right qualities, and ultimately God is within you, the true God is within you, and that's going to win out. And there's no question in my mind it's going to win out. And so then I agree to say, yeah, I see what you're saying. See, so that's Jesus' attitude to all of us, but we have to agree with it. So, you know, if Jesus invites us to his place, we don't want to accept it, then that's no good. So he's not going to embarrass us by that, by issuing invitations to those who turn him down. He's going to only invite those who agree to go. So the real ticket is your acceptance of this, your acceptance of this. Okay, I said, yes, absolutely, I'll go. And it's just like on the honor system, you know, and hiking and recreation, you know, you're under honor. You don't litter. You don't cut down trees. You don't ruin nature. You don't do this. You don't do that. This is how we're raised. We're raised in such strict honor that this is how an honorable person, you know, behaves. And we're not going to monitor you. We're not going to bother you. We're not going to pester you. We're not going to be hovering around you. We're not going to be taking pictures. We're not going to be doing this and that. That we're just going to, we understand that you're going to wobble sometimes, etc. But we feel you're going to walk straight and true through life, pretty straight and true through life, just like the rest of us have. And we've done it, and we know you're going to do it too. And our ancestors did it, and so way back, you know. So this is so important. So important. People believe in you. They believe in the best in you. Now, in my case, I said, yeah, I agree this. And I believe I'm going to get, you know, an invitation from Jesus. And they said, whoa, wait a minute. We don't believe you'll be quite that great. You know, they thought I was egotistical or something. But they, you know, I proved them wrong. They just didn't think that was possible. You know, It takes a tremendous amount of intense work of sitting quietly and sorting this through and saying, whoa, this fear, where does this fear come from? Why is this fear? Why am I believing in this fear? How is that justified? Where does this come from? What's the roots of this fear? You know, what? How do I flip this? What's the real truth? I mean, it's just this massive effort to sort through it and get clear about it So it's not that people believed, you know, we could really attain the greatest heights, but they believed that we could at least go in that direction. And it's up to us what we make of it, up to us. And people would say, well, I can't really expect that of you, you know. It's not like they said, well, you can't do it. They said, well, I don't really expect that of you. That's more than any of us can really expect, you know. But we still trust that you're going to do your best, and whatever you do, we know you'll do your best. But now we live in this hideous, litigious culture. I mean, my God, the instances I've had in my life of people just, no one's ever, you know, threatened to sue me, or I've never threatened to sue anybody, ever. I'm sorry, you know, I made a mistake. It's okay, don't worry, don't, you know, just, you know, be a little more attentive next time, and, you know, I've got to take responsibility for my life, you take responsibility for your life, and that's how it is. So there's no climate where litigiousness can take advantage. Now, of course, there's a need for law in business contracts and you know, there's all sorts of need for documents and contracts, etc., to keep track of things, you know, of course. So the law is an honorable profession. The way, ideally, it's a very honorable profession, no problem, but the idea of litigious society, of suing people, suing other ones, it breaks down the whole culture. It's a terrible cancer upon the entire culture, actually. One of many afflictions, one of many plagues that have been poured out upon this culture. Now, the Jews in Exodus from Egypt, they fled. What were they fleeing from? Well, they're fleeing from the plague. That's what they really were fleeing from. And the ancients used to use blood to protect them from the plague. Because the plague, of course, when you got sick, it felt like your blood was boiling. And, you know, they thought, you know, blood was life. And it was affecting your blood and your body. So they felt that there's something about your blood that was attracting this wrath of God, this pestilence, into your body and your blood. So what they did is they took blood and put it on their doors. So they thought the pestilence would be attracted to the blood on the doors. Are they sprinkling blood here, sprinkling blood there? And they say, go get that. Don't get me. Go get that. See, the blood's over there. The blood's over there. This is really, it's just pragmatic thinking. They said, wow, it seems like there's some hideous death that wants to get into my blood. So I'm going to pour a bunch of blood over here, and maybe it'll go over there instead of going after me, because it's easy blood. They don't have to get through my skin. You know, it's just out in the open. Easy food for you. Here, easy food. Take it. You know? It's like robbers coming and say, here's some money right here, I'll put it on the doorstep for you. Just take that, don't come into the house, you know, it'll save you the time. It's like that. That's all they're doing, they're propitiating. And so the plague in Egypt at that time was a plague that was killing all the young children, which plagues often do, right? And, you know, was it a type of bird flu? Was it, you know, no, not really, because that usually kills the older, stronger adults. But, it was some type of illness that afflicted the children. So all the young children were being killed off. And the Jews said, wow, we got to get out of here. So they put the blood on their, you know, lamb on their doors to try to ward off the plague. And then they said, let's get out of here, you know, and they're out of Egypt, away from the plague. So the plagues that are being poured out on the modern age right now are just horrible, horrible plagues. The new media is, you know, one of the worst plagues. Or the plague of litigious lawyers. Again, a legal career is an honorable profession. Let me be clear about that. Rightly practiced. Absolutely. You know, deeds to this, deeds to that. Keeping, you know, managing all of the legality of ownership and transference and deals, etc. And laws. Okay, it's a very honor, but there's been an infection. I mean, we're constantly bombarded by advertisements now, maybe second only to the pharmaceutical companies, about sue. Something happened to you? Personal litigation lawyer, we're going to sue from the last penny. You know, this kind of thing. Now, this is not good. And I'm not a supporter of Trump really at all. I'm just saying that God works in mysterious ways and helps bring out apocalyptic lifting the veils. But, you know, he's quoted as saying, if somebody hits me hard, I'm going to hit him back 100 times harder. And never going to be hit so hard, 100 times harder. This is an eye for an eye, tooth for tooth, and, you know, meaning if you go after me legally, I'm going to go after you 100 times more, you know, more viciously. Sue. This is not an attitude of forgiveness. Not at all. And, you know, he just recently fired one of his campaign manager or something, as an important aide or something, for posts, you know, years ago on Facebook or something, you know, as if the musings, you know, are supposed to, we're supposed to be held accountable for all our musings, as if this is truly representative. What is this nonsense? Where was freedom of speech? You know, I don't like anyone who attacks freedom of speech in that way. He got fired immediately because, of course, you know he's going to get attacked if he doesn't do that. But the idea of firing somebody is ridiculous. In the culture I grew up in, nobody was fired for what they said. Nobody was attacked. They just said, oh, if you said something they didn't like, just say, hey, you know, knock it off. And we know that's not what you really think. It's true. I mean, in moments of frustration, we boil over. It's not easy to speak truth in this world. So oftentimes, we try to speak truth, it gets all garbled. And I know very well what that's like. It's very difficult. So you may express it with all sorts of expletives and angry epithets and racial slurs and this. But what you're trying to do is you're trying to get to some truth. Hey, our culture is being ruined, which it is. It's being attacked and ruined. And however you express it, maybe it's ineloquent, okay? Well, does that mean you're a terrible person because you express something ineloquently? You express an important truth ineloquently? That means you're evil person and you can't govern your own life and you should be, you know, chopped, you know, pulled out like a weed? No. That is ridiculous. So Trump's acting in a very arrogant way like that, you know. That's not good at all. That's not the American way. He says, make America great again. Well, that's for me, that's the Brooklyn aggrandizement. He thinks that he knows it was. No, the culture that made America great is Judeo-Christian culture. That's what made America great. And trusting one another, and honoring one another, and forgiving one another, and not being politically correct. There was no political correctness, really. It didn't exist. Because we had this feeling that everybody's honorable deep down. They're all good. They're all honorable. But understood that some, as of yet, were still acting out of a great deal of fear. So you can't allow that to overrun. Just like in the cities, there's so much crime, so terrible, drug addiction and crime. You can't allow that to just overrun the city like Baltimore is experiencing right now. How many homicides in 1 month? Like 45? How much fear has been engendered in the population of that city? Okay, because the police have been told to stand down. How much fear? It brings a climate of fear. So we said no to that. We said, no. If you want to act in a dishonorable way and not trust one another, then you need to not be allowed to run amok. That's all. That's not being racist or anything like that. It's just common sense. You can't allow the fear mongers to run amok. Not fear mongers, but those who are actually instilling, you know, day to day, you know, I can't go to the store because I, you know, might be mugged or something. I gotta barricade myself in the house. He said, no, we don't want to live that in fear, like that. We don't want to live in fear. Now, as far as, you know, natural catastrophes and events like that, that's a different story. You know, warning people about that is not the same at all as being some drug dealer, you know, and criminal in the streets that are terrorizing the neighborhood. Some member of some gang that's just making life absolutely terrifying. We're having all sorts of home invasions now in this area, which was unheard of before. Completely. I mean, crime was so low that if there was even one crime, everybody was like, what? That's not possible. Yeah. Never happened. Now we have home invasions happening all the time, and people are getting alarm systems and worried about this and that, you know. And this was unheard of in growing up, and you know, in the culture that I grew up in. But you start bringing drugs and prostitution and gambling and all of this kind of thing into people's lives, and this is what starts happening, actually. Most of the stuff has criminal ties with it, you know? Yeah. So there's absolutely something to a culture which is on using strict morals. No gambling, no drugs, no fornication, no prostitution. And you know, on and on and on, where you know it's a very civil society, and this actually brings about less fear, and less fear enables one to start considering some very abstract considerations, like what is God really? And then ultimately you're able to untangle the whole situation. This is why I decry the collapse of civilization. I know it's making it too tough for people. I don't know what is going to be the disposition. Now, I've said I do believe in natural catastrophes. There's no question about it. And I do believe we're in a tribulation. We're going to be going to a tribulation period. I do believe that there is going to be quite a lot of troubles, without a doubt. I do believe in that. I have reason to believe in it. And ultimately, what's the disposition of everyone? You know, I don't know, but we need, somehow people need to have a culture which is not a fear-based culture, which, even if we use this mechanism of saying that Jesus took all the wrath of fear onto him, even though that's not true, you might say it's a convenient accommodation. It's a convenient accommodation that at least buys us a little breathing room. Okay. But you can do better than that. You can do better than that. For instance, I could be part of instilling a culture in some place, sometime, of truth where we really be, you know, free of fear to even greater extent, and be able to truly consider the truth and not need to resort to any of those accommodations that we have had to use previously, that we're safe from God's wrath because Jesus took it all on his head. We don't even need to go to that accommodation, not at all. So here, like, I don't worry about my neighbors or think about my neighbors at all. I mean, I know they can handle their lives and they'll behave in honorable ways, and I know I will too. There's never a thought about it. There's never a thought about our neighbors. We meet them, we say, happy to see you, how are you, have a great day. And absolute trust, you know, I mean, I would trust my house wide open with my neighbors here. If it was just a matter of these neighbors, I wouldn't even think twice about valuables, cars, house, anything. There's no way in the world any of them are going to cause any trouble or take anything, doesn't belong, or etc. This is my feeling. Now, of course, neighborhoods change, and there's a reason why people don't like their neighborhoods to change, is because you start having crime like this, and it brings fear into the neighborhood, and you have to start locking everything up. And it's terrible to be thinking about, oh, are the windows locked? Are all the doors locked? Are they chained? You know, is it got a password? Protect, fireball. This is hell. This is really hell. If you want to know what hell is, that's hell. So, you know, we very much don't like the attack against the police and the destruction of our police systems. As we've experienced here in where I live, the area near here, where they hardly have any police at all right now. It's so defunded. It's a wealthy, wonderful suburban area. The crime spiked 800%. And now they have to hire private security to protect the area, because the criminals found out there's no more police there, and they can just come in here and do whatever they want to do. So it brought about a climate of fear, you know, in the area, and just the whole feel has been changed. And of course, you know, it goes on and on and on. So there's an architect of destruction, of destroying Judeo-Christian culture and society taking place in America and around the world, actually, to bring about a climate of fear and contraction, which is what the ego's all about, which then in turns towards a technocracy and says, yeah, everyone needs to be monitored. Yeah, I want to be monitored so it's fair that someone else is monitored, because I'm afraid they're going to steal what I have. So if they're monitored, I'm not, that's not fair. You know, so let's make sure everybody's monitored, everybody's controlled. You know, this is their attitude. So trust no one is their attitude. Trust no one. And different societies and cultures have different levels of trust. Like I said, in the culture I grew up in, you know, like if you lose something, like a wallet, you don't have any fear at all. You say, oh, someone will turn it in for sure. Never worry. And you go, does someone turn it in? They say, oh yeah, of course. And the people you turn it into, they're not going to take anything either. So I wasn't afraid of losing my identity or, you know, someone stealing my identity. That was unheard of. So the level of fear that we're living in now is like a million times worse than it used to be, thanks to these architects of destructivity, you know, flooding the nation with those who have different values, different, fundamentally different values. I worked at a place, well, I don't want to get into that, but let me just say that I've certainly experienced it. There's honorable people everywhere, but there's also some cultures which have a different idea about it. You see? And it's like, oh, there's some keys in the car. Oh, God put that car there for me with keys in it so I could have the car, because I want the car, so they act on impulse, let me take it, like that. I know some older people who still leave the keys in the car. They just throw them on this, you know. If I'm in somebody's way, then they can move it. That's what we did. He said, okay, if I happen to be in someone's way, let me just leave the keys in the car. Yeah, we do that. Oh, okay, I mean, someone's in the way here, let me just back it out and move it over here. And that's it. Everybody trusts one another. We don't have that anymore. And it's by design. And it's the ego hating the culture that enables us to actually get free of this delusion of death. Remember, the ego is our own arrogance telling us how to accomplish the impossible, or advising us how to accomplish the impossible. Of course, we cannot accomplish the impossible. So its advice is all just, you know, rubbish. And yet, it gives us this advice as if it's absolutely certain that it's correct advice, because it's saying, well, you have to try this. See, how do you know it's not going to work unless you try it? You know, it's like, how do you know it's not, it's like, how do you know if you jump off a cliff that you're going to fall or something? I mean, you know, just to use a parallel, how do you know that we can't change the will of God? Because it's the will of God that we can't change the will of God. We didn't create the will of God. So the ego keeps saying, well, how do you know that you can't kill God and yourself if you don't try? Because we have this inner knowing that God has put there that we can't succeed. That's why. And the ego says, well, yeah, but God didn't want you to know that you could do this. And I said, no, that's not true. That's a lie. That's the lie. So that's the satanic Luciferian lies. How do you know you can't do it unless you try? So we keep trying. I say, well, we've tried and tried and tried and tried, and it doesn't work. And Jesus told us it doesn't work, and he's very reliable. And so we've gotten information from reliable sources that it doesn't work. God says it doesn't work, etc. So there's really no reason at all that suggests that it can work at all, except just our own arrogance to try and do it. That's all. It's just, and I put that down to our adventurousness. That's it. So, talking back to our theme about getting imitation from Jesus, well, you can see how I can talk and think, and you can do the same. You can absolutely, if you just give yourself the time and the opportunity to spend your days and your months and your years and your decades and your life working to clarify this, you can then get free and easy and expansive like this, so that you just say, oh yeah, I mean, this is all easily true to me. I accept it. You can do it. I did it right here in this world. But I came into the world at a time where there was still this, you know, idyllic trust and honor. Now, certainly it helps if there's an abundance, you know, and people feel like they're not starving and needing things. If you come from a culture where it's just survival, you're going to steal stuff. You know, you say, I just got to survive. I have all these children. They're not doing any food. I'm going to find a way to, if I don't have a job, I'm going to find a way to get money. If I have to steal stuff, I'll steal stuff. You know, that's part of it, but not necessarily all of it, actually. You can come from a culture, many cultures are death-based, okay, where they haven't heard the gospel of Jesus, where they haven't gotten a breath of fresh air, even though this is an accommodation, where they feel like, we worship death, we have to act in a way that keeps fear, we have to live in a climate of fear. And so their actions are impulsed from that, where they're very impulsive. See something, grab something, take it. You know, like the looting that takes place when they're rioting in these cities. That is just such a disgrace from the standpoint of the culture I grew up in. There is no way in the world that anybody that I ever grew up with or I know would ever take one thing from any business owner that was disadvantaged in some way. If there was fires or whatever, the police had vacated the city. Wouldn't take one single thing. In fact, we would defend the place. Now, you know, it's easy to say that, well, we have a TV stuff. Not necessarily. We weren't privileged or wealthy or anything. And not everybody is. It's just you don't do that. You know, they worked hard. You know, we worked hard. And business people work hard. Everybody works hard for what they get. They apply their minds, etc., to it. And this is their right. This is their legal right. They're selling the merchandise. You have no right to take that at all. None. Zero. What kind of culture says that that's okay and people do that? That is very, very, very sketchy, to say the least. Very fear-based, very impulsive. So, you know, the store owners used to just leave their stores open. They'd go out for lunch or go somewhere, go do an errand. It was okay. I'll be right back. You know, they lock their doors sometimes, sometimes not. They'd have free candy there for you, for the kids. And it's honor, based on honor system. You know, you do not act on impulse. You do not take what is not yours, period. No exceptions to that whatsoever. And so this has gradually been decaying and decaying and decaying and decaying. The media playing up, sensationalizing a few situations here and there, making it seem like it's so dangerous, so terrible, scare you. It's the ego. The media is very much a tool of the ego in trying to contract us, fear. The ego does not care how it contracts you at all. That's why I say the ego is completely insane. It doesn't understand what you're saying at all when you're talking with it. You think you're dialoguing with the ego, but the ego is not understanding a word you're saying. All it's focused on is contracting you into fear, like that. That's it. That's its measurement. It takes one measurement. Are you becoming more fearful? Are you becoming more contracted? Which puts you more into trying. Are you becoming more dead? Are you pretending? Are you seeming more dead-like than before? Are you dying to spirit? Of course, it's pretense, but is your pretense seem more and more realistic? Are you really contracted and fearful? You know, okay, that's what the ego's after. And even in an ideal, trustworthy place, the ego can drive you down into that, which the ego did drive me down into that, because it was the inner dialogue, you'll be very careful about inner dialogue. It's a dangerous thing, inner dialogue. All dialogue is very dangerous, actually, because you're using words and concepts which don't mean anything except the goodwill and honor of those who are speaking with one another, okay? And the ego can easily pretend to be having a discussion with you, but what it does is subtly, legalistically, it knows how to turn everything and it begins spiraling down, and to feel contraction, fear. And I've experienced this whenever I try to talk with somebody dialogue-wise, it always goes this direction. Because they're not able to keep it from doing that. So I don't find that discussing situations is helpful at all. I find that working on affirmations, working on your own flipping of the script, okay, and full stop in the wow, these are the techniques, these are the tools that actually work for you, for anyone. Assert the truth about us. Assert the truth about truth, actually. Assert the truth about truth. Only truth is true and nothing else is true. And that's why A Course in Miracles by Jesus was a self-study. It wasn't supposed to be group study. It wasn't supposed to be dialogue study. It was supposed to be self-study, that you learn, get the tools, and you apply them. Okay, and this is how you unseat the ego, its influence over you, is you don't do it through dialogue or discussion groups. And the Holy Spirit kept me away from all those. Say, don't have anything to do with any of those things. I said, yeah, but there's some nice people over here, so they like to get together and discuss A Course in Miracles. And the Holy Spirit said, no, you just stay on track. We're fast tracking you. You know, that's going to slow you down. Is the Holy Spirit. I said, don't slow down. That'll slow you down. So it's the continual focus on these assertions, saying, yes, this is true, and your recognition. So yesterday I went to work, the last 2 days, on the weekend, where I went through the lessons of A Course in Miracles, and I took these graphics of Jesus and Nicholas Roark backgrounds and blends of those, and I put lesson 1 through 301 of A Course in Miracles. I ran out of video and pictures, so I couldn't go further, but you know, that gives you a good start. And I put these on my blog. There's a blog with all of these pictures, each one with a lesson of A Course in Miracles. And I said, I suggest that you simply go over those a couple times a day, and I'm going to try to do, especially before I go to bed, is just go. You don't have to spend a lot of time on each one. Just this, and just affirm them. Just say in your mind, say it and affirm it and believe it and accept it and go to the next. And just do this several times a day. I'm going to try and do this. It may take a while for the blog page to, I think it's the August 3rd blog page, ACM lessons 1 through 301. And this is the kind of work I'm trying to help people out of love. I want them to get a ticket too. I want to get the invitation from Jesus. This is what I want. So I'm putting before you what I think is the most helpful and best stuff. This is what I do. For everyone. See, I'm not biased towards anyone. I'm saying anyone in the world can look at this, wherever, through whatever medium, you know, whether, right? I mean, you've got to go on the internet to do it. But anyone, I'm not excluding anybody. I trust everybody that if they do this, it's going to help them greatly. Now, not every lesson will strike you at a particular day or moment, but some will hit home. And this is important. And when it hits home, you just say, wow, you feel the trust of God in you. I mean, Jesus trusts us so much. God trusts us completely. God knows that we're absolutely exactly as God created us. Jesus knows we're exactly as God created us, and we can never deviate from that in the slightest. But even though we're pretending that there's a way eventually to deviate from it, we shall never find such a way. So we've never deviated from what we are, and we never will. Okay, so we're absolutely sinless. 100%. We're trying to sin, but we're failing. We can only fail. And of course, this God of guilt and judgment is furious at our failings. You know, wrathful punishing. We got to propitiate that. You know, and we've developed these religions of propitiation. And but none of that is true. We cannot sin. We're sinless. We're absolutely sinless. So you get this feeling of trust in God trusts us and honors us. You get that feeling by going through these lessons, which is very important. It's like, wow, God really knows what I truly am, and knows I cannot deviate from this, knows I haven't deviated from it, and there's nothing to forgive. There's no sins I've never, no sin of deviation whatsoever. I've never sinned against God. I can't. It's impossible. And God knows this, and God knows that I know it too, and so everything is fine. Not even any need for forgiveness, really. We need to forgive ourselves for believing in forgiveness. The real forgiveness is to believe, forgive ourselves for even believing that we could ever need any forgiveness. Just like the final judgment is a judgment that we never needed any judgment and never will. This is the ultimate purpose of A Course in Miracles, course of any course towards truth. It doesn't have to be titled A Course in Miracles. This is the ultimate end game of it, is this realization. We have not deviated from what we are, even though we're having this dream of a scheme of deviation, pretending to be dead and pretending that there's this judge that can then judge us, that you are officially dead, that which means spirit died, which means God died, and now spirit has the greater will, so now the winner will now automatically resurrect and be the new prime creator. We just invented the scheme. It's not real. It's all illusion. It's all just a dream. So you can see, if Jesus were to, if they had a realm that reflects this truth, you know, I might not freak out. I might say, oh yeah, this is great, I love it. Now the question would be, well, how do you help others get here, which would be my focus, of course. How do you extend invitation, say, hey, this is what the work you need to do. So I'm always working on whatever I can do to make available to everyone what I believe was helpful for them to get that invitation, which I want everyone to have, for sure. Everyone, even the architects of destruction, because they cannot deviate either. They certainly believe in deviation, but belief is not God's will. You see, God's will is God's will, and God's will is that we can never deviate from the perfection and the perfect freedom that we are. We are an idea in the mind of God. So Jesus' realm, I believe, is a realm that reflects eternal life, okay? It's a perceptual reflection. It's a pretending that we're eternal life. And for a while, we pretend we're eternal life, and then ultimately we drop pretending altogether. So we can get an invitation. As a matter of work at asserting. Get these assertions into your system, you know? And so I avoid dialogue. I really avoid it. The idea of me going out and talk has never worked for me at all, because people cannot stay for even a few minutes. Immediately they get legalistic, and the ego immediately engages on how can we pull this whole, the whole tone of this thing, how can we pull it down into more contraction, because this guy's too expansive. You know, and I'm getting a lot of negativity right now because I'm very expansive right now, obviously, because I know that the time is near, and I notice people kind of look at me like, you know, I don't like, you're too expansive, I don't like that. I need to stay in this fear, death fear vibration, and you're not really have that vibration anymore. But people feel like they're being attacked, you know, because they feel, oh, you can bring the wrath of God upon me. If I forget about death, then the wrath of God will descend upon me. Some sort of wrath, or I will lose status, or whatever. So here I am saying, well, you know, I'm just feeling like, wow, you get the invitation to paradise, you know, just, and people say, oh, stay away. God's going to punish me or something. Or if they don't believe in God, they say, at least I'm going to lose status, you know. I'm not going to find my human potential. I'm not going to get true happiness, you know. I've got to die first. I've got to have an authentic death in order to attain that. You know, authentic death is what they're after. And so they don't want me around. It's the truth. It's true. They don't want me around. So, yeah, I find dialogue doesn't work at all. Not doesn't help us. It helps us stall out. Yeah, but it doesn't help us get that invitation. So, assertion. Allow your mind, open your mind to these assertions, which I certainly have. I like teaching that is just like all these assertions. Okay, that is just one after the other. Jesus makes so many assertions in the Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words. It's very assertive, making assertions in so many ways. You are the Holy Son of God. You can never sin. The only eternal life is the only life there is. You know, these kind of things. This is the food that Jesus tells us. This is the true Eucharist. This is the true Passover. This is the true blood of the Lamb. This is these assertions. That is the true spirit, the bread of eternal life that Jesus brought down for us. It's his teachings. It's his assertions. It's his assertiveness. He's merely asserting that we never deviated from God one bit from what we are, and we never can. That's his primary assertion, and he asserts it in many, 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 many ways. This is the kind of friend that you're looking for. Okay, a friend who is assertive about truth, the truth of what you of what you are, and asserts it in many, many different ways. So I try to be that assertive, and produce whatever I can do, whatever work I can do, videos, graphics, sound, whatever. Assert. So get used to doing that. Jesus said you should do like the way the cow chews its cud constantly. You should always be asserting, and I could do a lot better job, I know. But the stress of what I'm doing already is I'm already, you know, putting, you know, enormous effort into it. I have 365 more background graphics that are all extraordinarily beautiful. My job is to attach assertions to every one of those and make them available for you. I may post all of them just to give you, those of you who are into it, give you the opportunity, because again, not every assertion will resonate with you. Okay, this is very important to point this out and not to feel guilty or something's wrong with me. Because I'll go through, read A Course in Miracles, I'll go through all the lessons I see, and some of them like leave me like, oh, I'm even feeling bad. But others will suddenly hit my heart. I just feel my heart like, oh, that is so true. I love that. Thank you, Jesus. That is fantastic assertion. So take it to heart. But Jesus says just one, any one of these assertions taken to heart is all you need. So all you're looking for is that reaction, you know, the wow reaction, where you let it into your being, not your physical heart or anything like that, and not some sense. You let it into your being. You say, ah, this is true. I know this is true. I accept this as my truth. Jesus said, just one instant, that calls it the holy instant, is enough. Okay. But you need to practice the holy instant to accept it, to say, yes, this, I can abide in this. But ultimately, if he said, if we truly, unreservedly accepted, one is enough. So don't feel bad or put off at all if you go through assertions and like, only, you know, like, oh, that's not really hitting the spot. This isn't. It's like at the Cheesecake Factory. You go in and there's the cheesecake, you know, and you say, well, what do I have today? Well, not that one. Now that's the one I want. You know, you can look at 30 different varieties of this cheesecake, just scrumptious cheesecake. And you might say, no, I don't want that one. I don't want that. None of them hits the spot. And then one will say, oh, yeah. The double chocolate lemon, you know, whatever. I mean, I want that one. And then you get that one to eat and say, oh, it's fabulous. And I actually want some cheesecake right now talking about it. But this is the same. Okay, just think you're going through the Cheesecake Factory. Okay, this assertion, that one. I love that one. Same with the graphics. I go through the graphics and then one of them will just hit me and I say, oh my gosh. Just love it. I just love it. I just love it. I just suddenly feel the spaciousness and the freedom from fear, you know, and all this, which is our birthright, our inheritance, which we can never deviate from at all. We can dream of deviation, but we can't really deviate at all, not one bit. Never can we. And you say, oh, that's, and so you let that in, and you start the wow, you start resonating. So it's just a matter of you doing that every day, getting to wow as often as possible during the day, is the way to get that invitation to Jesus's place. Every day, get to the wow as much as possible. That's it. Anyone can do it. You just have to make it your business to do it. And in so doing, you know, you're probably not going to be some, you know, high status, big shot in society and culture. But Jesus said, don't lay up your treasures here in this world where, you know, things rust and moss corrupt and everything's corrupted, right? He said, don't you lay it up in the world that is to come, so to speak, that the death-free realm. Make that your goal. That's your goal. This here is like you're staying in some rundown hotel or motel zero or something. Yeah, and yeah, there's always derelicts and crime and drug addicts and corruption and all that. Yeah, don't try to be a big shot in this world. Put your emphasis on the wow of truth, that we have never deviated one bit from the perfection that God created us as. And we can't. We're incapable of doing so. Keep hammering this point home from whatever angle that you can hammer it home. And there can be many different angles, okay? We're not trying to limit this to an exclusive Judeo-Christian context at all, no. Whatever verbiage you want to use, whatever tradition you want to use, there's many ways to hammer this home, that we cannot deviate from our perfection that God created us as. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. This is absolute gospel truth. However you want to express it, however what your traditions are, whatever your teachers are, whatever your, you know, the holy books may be, whatever. Keep hammering home the truth that we can never deviate from what we are, the perfection we are. When we're not a body, we're free, we're still spirit, exactly as God created all of us to be. We're formless essence, we're formless idea. There's no fear, we're absolute freedom. Keep hammering this home. That's all that Jesus does. I call him the hammer, okay, because he keeps hammering these assertions. One after the other, after the other, after the other, after the other. Just read it. You read it that way and just wow. Just, you know, assertion, 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 assertion. And when you start taking it in, it's just wow. You just feel, you know, you're just being hammered. All the falsities being hammered out of you. So, you know, where do you find such a hammer? Well, Jesus is a great hammer indeed. Where do you find someone who's a non-stop fount of assertions of truth? Unapologetic. You see, Jesus is unapologetic. That's what I love about Jesus, among everything else. He's unapologetic. And this is a quality we're looking for. This is why Trump has gotten so much pull. He's unapologetic, okay? And in our culture, we're taught that we're so bad and so wrong, we got to apologize for everything. I mean, you go out the door apologizing, especially if you're a white male. You're apologizing because you're supposedly the cause of everybody's unhappiness. You know, Judeo-Christian culture, you're making everyone unhappy. They can't go gambling and whoring and drinking and impulsing and, you know, doing whatever they want to do and you know, paganizing and drinking, feasting and, you know, the senses and... Oh, you've got this white bread Puritan culture is terrible. No, nobody's happy, you know. So you're responsible. Everyone's unhappiness. Apologize. Well, Trump is a guy who doesn't apologize for anything. Not because he's Jesus, but he's an egomaniac, or basically. But even that sees a silver lining, because we at least get the feeling, hey, maybe I need to stop apologizing for everything, you know. So there's a positive. There is a silver lining there. Really, seriously. I mean, I know there's a lot of people saying, you know, I like him because he doesn't apologize. And we're sick and tired of apologizing. You know, oh, yeah, it's all the police's fault. Right. You know, right. What, you know, utter upside down insanity nonsense, okay, that we're being stuffed down everyone's throats. We need to stop apologizing. And what I love about Jesus, he's unapologetic about what he tells us. He does not apologize in one bit. He says, this is the truth, and I'm not apologizing for it. You know, and this is what is so awesome, you know, just to hear that. You know, it's just like, oh my God, it's like spiritual oxygen for us. It's like breathing the air of spiritual authenticity. And this is why we say thank you, Jesus. I don't say thank you, Jesus, because I think that Jesus died and took all the wrath of an angry God upon him and suffered all of it, and so that I didn't have to suffer from it. No, I say thank you, Jesus, because he's absolutely unapologetic about the truth. And this is what we need. Because if you get some wishy-washy, apologetic person, you know, that makes you all nervous and fearful. I don't really know, you know. We want someone who just says, this is truth, and I love telling it to you, and I'm not apologizing for giving it to you and telling you this, and I'm not apologizing for this at all. You know, you cannot do the impossible. I'm not apologizing for that. I'm not saying, I'm so sorry you can't do the impossible. So I know it's terrible, and I wish we could. And it says, no, I don't wish you could. If you could, you would be annihilating yourself. So, no, you cannot do the impossible. And I'm happy that you can't. You have never sinned, and I'm happy that you never have sinned. You know, there is no angry God, and I'm happy that there's no angry God. I'm not apologizing for that one bit. So, Jesus is this non-apologetic mind, you know, spirit. And just the great opportunity to spend time with that is just tremendous. And this is a wow. We're not used to it. We're not used to it at all. We have so many people who don't know what they're talking about. My gosh. And to finally hear someone speak the truth and be unapologetic about it, you know, is a great blessing. So, you know, if I find a great, wonderful golf course, you know what? I'm happy for the people who built it and sustain it and make it available. Thank you very much. Now, I'm not playing golf these days. I haven't played in maybe 2 or 3 years, hardly, you know. But this is an example. Thank you for making this, you know. Thank you. So I'm just saying, thank you, Jesus, for making this show, revealing your unapologetic nature of truth to us, you know, so that we can hang out there. Just like someone makes a beautiful golf course, what do they want? They want you to come and enjoy it, right? He said, look at this wonderful place, you know, I want you to enjoy it. I made it so you could enjoy it. My friends could enjoy it. And my friends are those who come and truly enjoy it. Those are my friends. So Jesus is saying, hey, I want my friends to enjoy truth. So here's a way to hang out with, like, A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, and the students of Jesus. I want to extend, you know, the invitation to say, hey, hang out, enjoy it. Hang out, enjoy. This is great. Thank you, Jesus, for making this possible, to extend, you know, your invitation, saying, look, this is how you get ready for my place come visit my place. This is how you get ready for it. The death-free realm is not apologizing for being the death-free realm, not at all. It's the ones that are trying to die that need to be apologetic and say, like, what the heck am I doing? I'm trying to kill God, is really what we're doing here. Remember, this pretend death is really an attempt to kill God, plain and simple. So we should be apologizing for that. I mean, say, wow, I mean, sorry to be so stupid. You know, I got to repent. I got to set down this whimsical caprice. I'm sorry, God, for trying to deviate. You know, I know I can't. I'm sorry for trying. It's ridiculous. I'm sorry for being so foolish. You know, so if anyone's apologetic, it's those who are trying to deny truth. Not those that accept truth. Those that accept truth, why do they need to be apologetic? Those who are not committing crime, why the heck should they be apologetic? And just, it doesn't mean that just that only rich people don't commit crime because they have plenty. That is not true at all. You have some very poor people who live in dignity and wouldn't think of taking anything of their neighbors. It's an attitude of honor and trying to keep fear out of their culture. Or an attitude of sharing too. You need something, fine, to go ahead and take it. You need it, that's okay. My attitude is, somebody takes something, they needed it more than I did. That's what we're taught. Don't be angry with them. Say, oh, okay, well, somebody was more needy than I did, so that's okay. But of course, that can be the architects of fear, try to take advantage of that and say, hey, why don't you just go and grab everything you want? You know, no, we mean, if somebody's so desperate, then, you know, fine. But we're not talking about an overall culture of this is just go in and pillage. That's a pillage culture. That's a vandal culture, you know. That's not what we're talking about. That's just a culture's lazy culture. It says, hey, let me grab the fruits of somebody else's labor so I can be lazy and keep on wenching and drug taking and believing in fear, because I'm so attracted by fear I can't do it myself. I don't have the discipline to do it myself. So let me just steal from somebody else because I don't have the discipline. You know, that just is just fear culture trying to dominate. That's not what we want. The thing about getting free of fear is it enables you to be very disciplined and not non-impulsive. So you're able to work out in your mind, you know, scenarios in your mind. Where you're able to recognize, okay, what can I do here? What can I do here? You give it clear, calm thought, clear, calm attention. Clear, and ultimately you turn to reason and listen to reason, which is what Jesus tells us. Really the Logos, the Word, etc., is really the Holy Spirit. It's reason, actually. And this was given to us by God, so we have a way to set aside our arrogance, actually. So really, in the beginning, there was no need for reason. Reality doesn't need reason at all. It just is. There's no alternative. So there's nothing to reason out. It's completely natural. There's no call for reasoning in reality at all. And Jesus tells that once everyone has used reason to restore their sanity, as it were, that the Holy Spirit will remain, the Logos, the Word, will remain Word of God, but as a blessing function, as just this augmentation of blessing for all of creation. You know, so it's all good. But there's no actual thinking and reasoning once you're completely accepted reality as it is and stop, you know, gave up this attempt to try and, you know, be greater than reality. There's no need for reasoning because it's all perfect, a perfect knowing, a perfect knowingness, a perfect spontaneity. Now, as far as learning all the lessons of Jesus, some of them I'm really good at, some of them I'm not good at all. So I'm just, you know, I'd say just an average student. But average is good enough. I guess I got the invitation, so I'm good enough. But sure, I got a long ways to go. There's some of his affirmations I don't understand really that well. But I can feel that they're right. But I can't quite explain why they're right. You know, to give is to receive. You know, I guess I understand it because all giving is really extension in the kingdom of heaven. So if you're giving something, that means you must have it. So the way to prove that you to actually have something is you have to extend it. So in the giving of something, you are receiving it then. So without extending, the way the kingdom is, without extending, you can't receive. You receive through extension, through giving. Of course, in the world here of things, that seems preposterous, right? Because you give something away, you don't have it. So Jesus is talking about ideas. And then, like, you know, you become aware of that you truly have it by being able to extend it. That means by extending it means you do have it. You see, this is what he's talking about. I believe this is what he's talking about. So, you know, all these things seep in. You know, don't worry if you don't get it. There's a lot of stuff I don't get still. Some of it resonates strongly, some a little less strongly, but that's okay. You don't have to be perfect. You know, you just have to put the effort in and do the best you can. Jesus says, you do your part, and God will do God's part, and God does the majority of it. You just need a little bit of willingness is all that's required, actually. Now, it may seem a lot of willingness on our part, but it's really just a little willingness to just, I mean, how many people are going to go and actually look at those lessons of A Course in Miracles, which is scrollable. It may take a while for them to load, so you got to be patient. Once the page loads with all those graphics, and your computer's fast enough and it's in memory, whatever, you don't have a lot of programs open when you're doing this, because it may clog your memory. I restarted my computer. I'll restart it and I'll go there and check it out for you. But you can scroll. You just scroll through. You can through all those lessons just like that. Easily scroll through them. That takes a little bit of willingness, doesn't it? Absolutely it does. Just like it took willingness for me to compose all these graphics and put it all together and make it available. It took, you know, effort and focus. Absolutely. So how many are going to do that? You know, I'm amazed in this world where very few are even able to give even a little bit of will, just a little will. Not even that. They're so frightened, you know, about if I don't successfully pretend to be dead, I'll never be happy. This is what we told. This is what the ego tells us. The only way to happiness is you got to succeed in convincing guilt that you're dead. That's it. And so you think, I can't even give a second to this other thing because that's not really on track. You know, I've got to stay on track of convincing guilt that I am authentically dead. So characteristically, people here don't even give the little lifetime with not even one instance of willingness, not even any little willingness. They are shut down entirely. They won't even if I put it right in their hands, they won't do it. I mean, it's like I got to do all this work and make it easy. People will not even, no matter how easy you make it, they still won't do it. This is, what can you do? You know, I don't know, it's very frustrating, but this is the situation. So I just highly recommend that the materials I'm making available to you, if you want an, this is certainly a way, not the only way, but it can be a way to get that invitation. You want that invitation. You don't want to keep living in a place that's dedicated to death, okay, which is what this world is. It's absolutely dedicated to death from top to bottom. And you've got this vicious media right now. I mean, you can't even describe how different it is from what it used to be to what it is now. It used to be honorable journalism. There were honorable journalists. You know, nowadays they're just vicious bloodsuckers, and just going, you know, for the fear and the death and the contraction. That's all they're going for. They just want to contract into technocracy. That's all that they're after. That's it. Hyenas, you know, lower than hyenas, actually, in a lot of ways. The jackals, lower than the hyenas, and the jackals, unfortunately, they're you know, trapped in this fear thing. I said, the only way to happiness is to die. The only way to happiness is to die. I've got to have an authentic spiritual death, or I can never get happiness. This is the Antichrist arrogance that is, you know, this world is being subjecting itself to, you know. So is it still recording? Yeah. Who wants to stay within that situation? Who would really say, oh, this is great, this is really where I want to be, I love this, massive contraction, and it's all constant. I mean, who? Nah, I don't love it. Not at all. So this is horrible. It's very tough to fend this off. So I'm trying to make as much material as possible. Now, if I put up these assertions, other assertions, and maybe I'll just put up again on this blog. I was able to load all these on a blog. I didn't realize you could do this. And you can scroll through it. This is like very effective. The Holy Spirit suggested this. I said, well, I didn't think it's possible. I mean, but this blog, the blog site allows me to upload like hundreds of pictures on one posting. I mean, this is extraordinary. And you can scroll through them, and you'll find some that help you. And this is all that's really required. Anything that triggers the wow and really gets you thinking, wow, I cannot deviate from perfection. It's not really possible, is it? Just that little glimpse of saying, wow, I cannot deviate from perfection, can I? I cannot deviate from eternal life. I am eternal life. There is no deviation. I am eternal life. There is no deviation. Plain and simple, right? This is an assertion. I am eternal life. There is no deviation. Just one of those is super, super helpful to you. And you will not get that in the media, in the entertainment, the information society. You will not get any of that. You will not get any of that. It's a desert, absolute desert. And I like being an oasis in the desert. This is what I'm into. I love oasis in the desert. Love it. Love it, love it, love it. Because, this is saying, hey, you don't have to dwell in the desert, right? There is no deviation. I can never deviate. Okay, I can never deviate. It's impossible. There is no deviation. There is no deviation. I cannot deviate from my perfection. I cannot deviate from my protection. There is no deviation. Assert, 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 assert like that. This is then you're living in an oasis, and the desert is pushed away. You push the desert away from you. The oasis of truth is there. You just have to push the desert away from you, and you do that through making these assertions. Now, I may have pushed the desert of desolation away from me so much that I'm going to end up in paradise. It's very likely I will, because I kept pushing the desert away. It's this hot desert. You can't get me, because I'm saying I cannot deviate from what I am. It's impossible. I can never deviate from the perfection of what I am. I cannot deviate from what I am. It's impossible. Deviation from what I am is impossible. Deviation from identity is impossible. Okay, so this is how you push the desert away. And when you push the desert away, what is there by default? It's this gorgeous, lush oasis by default. By default. It's like you take a blower and blow all the sand away. What's there? Oh my gosh, look at this gorgeous, luscious waters everywhere. Lush oasis. Oh my, it's beautiful. This is why I've always been attracted to a desert setting, an oasis in a desert setting. Is because you're aware that you do have to push something away. You see? Whereas like where I'm living, it's not like that. But it's helpful to see it. Wow, there is, if I don't keep asserting, there is this harshness that's going to come back on me. So it's important to be grateful for the oasis that you're in, and every day say, wow, I got this nice air conditioning. It's 120 outside. I better keep pushing, keep pushing the harshness away, like that. It's motivational. Many of the oases, many of the nice places were in the past were surrounded by rather harsh landscape, right? River, Antioch, Alexandria. I mean, speaking of Alexandria, holy cow. I mean, the ancient history, I was ignorant of it to some extent. I realized it this morning. I woke up, I said, hey, I don't think I came across this astonishing statistic. And we're doing a little cool down here, okay, it's fine. Remember, the tools I'm making available on this blog and on Facebook and various places, I'll Twitter out and say I have some new material for you. also. So you can, you know, I advise people to join, you know, follow my Twitter account, because what I do is I tweet out assertions, or I'll say, hey, I just put up some new material on my blog, or, you know, and check it out. Look at all these great assertions that you can use. So right now I have 2 followers on Twitter, you know, and I invite everybody to follow me on Twitter, or, you know, so I will tweet out. I just put up, you know, 60 new graphics. Each one has this wonderful assertion. So you get to go there and you say, wow, and you can actually spend some time doing this. I mean, I don't know how I can do any better. I really don't know how I can do any better than what I'm doing right now. It's just people have to start getting with it. So I have the links on the description of the video. On each video, I try to post these links. I have Facebook, blog, Twitter, and my website. And I feel like Twitter is a way that you can just be updated. Of course, you have to join Twitter, I guess. But you can just go to the link and check in. You probably make a bookmark and check in. What did I tweet? I don't think you have to be a member of Twitter just to actually read a tweet. And the post you do. And then go check it out. I'm doing the best I can. I was up to 2:30 in the morning last night, slaving away at this. Just slaving away at it. Hurting my eyesight, you know, just... So... it'd be great if people would actually start getting some benefit from this and realize that by just going over these assertions, keep scrolling through these assertions, keep scrolling through it, you're going to be, some of them are going to impact you. And some of them, you might be overwhelmed. That's the one I'm worried about. But given human nature, given the situation we're in, you know, a lot of them just won't hit home, probably. A lot of them won't hit home. But some will. And so I just have to put it in your hands, and you have to govern yourself and not overload yourself, but at the same time don't underdo it either. So anyway, Alexandria, I woke up, I came across a statistic a couple nights ago before I went to sleep last night, and I was really blown away by it. I was absolutely flipped my entire perspective on ancient history. I just could not fathom this, but it is estimated that in Alexandria, for instance, in the time of Jesus, even before the time of Jesus, actually before, where Alexandria was at its real height, before the Ptolemies began to, you know, decay, and Rome took it over. Octavian took it over, I believe, for Rome, and in 30 BC, I think. The Jewish population of Alexandria in Egypt, okay, the Jewish population was around 1 million Jews living in Alexandria, and they only populated 2/4 of the city. Alexandria was the greatest city of antiquity. It was Greece's crowning jewel. Okay, Alexander the Great, the empire of Alexander the Great was, you know, the greatest empire the world's ever seen. Massive, massive wealth poured into that empire. And it poured, the Ptolemies made Alexandria their capital city. These were Greek rulers of Egypt. I mean, Alexander the Great conquered Egypt and put Greek rulers in there. And Egypt was massively wealthy, exporting grain all over. And trade ships coming out of this great port of Alexandria. It was like the New York of the ancient world. It really was. I mean, New York has what now? About like 2 million Jews in New York right now. Well, back in Alexandria, had 1 million Jews back then living there. Some of them were very wealthy bankers, money changers, merchants, etc. A lot of them were artisans, very skillful artisans. Okay. I mean, this Alexandria was the center, intellectual and cultural, and business, economic center of the world. Okay, and there were Jews spread out in villages. Well, 1 million was a general, you know, idea of how many Jews, but most Jews lived in Alexandria or around Alexandria. Okay, it was the intellectual center of the world, period. For hundreds and hundreds of years, it was. Astonishing city. Alexander had his chief architect, his genius architect, lay it out, and they just built it on those old trading village or something, and it was a stupendous city with massive monuments and colonnades and buildings gilded with gold. I mean, the riches were so rich that the synagogue of the Jews, the chief synagogue of Alexandria, was one of the modern, I mean, was one of the ancient wonders of the world. It was just this absolutely gorgeous temple, synagogue, with gold, gilded with gold and marble columns. I mean, it was just, you know, the wealth was astonishing in Alexandria. You know, the ancient cities of Nineveh and Babylon having been destroyed, Alexandria stood alone as the greatest city in the world for hundreds of years. Most populous city in the world, too. Thriving. They built ships that carried a thousand soldiers on one ship. They built these massive green ships that with commerce, huge amount of commerce flowing, like New York. And so this was the center of the world, Alexandria. I mean, Jesus is said to have gone to Alexandria when Joseph and Mary were fleeing. You know, Herod wanted to have the children of Bethlehem under 2 years old killed. Apparently, there wasn't that many of them, but you know, still they fled down to. Well, where were they? You know, you always told in the Bible they fled into Egypt, and that kind of left them there. They fled into Egypt, and I was brought up thinking that this whole ancient world Jesus lived in was some really like shanty town, impoverished, poor, just burrows and sandals and little villages and little candlelight and to till your crops and subsistence. And this wasn't true at all. And I think Jesus fled in Egypt. Oh, poor Jesus and Mary and Joseph, they fled into Egypt. I mean, what are they living in? Tents, catching fish? How do they live? I mean, it's like, you know, I mean, and this whole worldview just got blown up. I woke up this morning very depressed and angry, actually. I said, I've been lied to my whole life about this whole context of the ancient world was that we've been taught. It just simply isn't true. Just a simple little village life. That is not true at all. The Jews were extremely cosmopolitan people, for one thing. And Jesus was a Jew. When he went down to Egypt, where'd he go? He went to Alexandria, if the story is true. He went to relatives in Alexandria. And the Alexandrian Jews were extraordinary benefactors of Jerusalem and rebuilding the temple. That's where the money came from. And they had tremendous power and influence in And Philo, who was a philosopher from Alexandria, was very, very influential. He was tied into all the royal families of Greece, of Rome, of the Jews in Jerusalem. I mean, he was so well placed and powerful. The Jews, where they lived? They lived in Alexandria, they lived in Damascus, they lived in Antioch. The diaspora happened way before the destruction of Jerusalem in the 70 AD, and then the later one in 130, what was it, 130 something. The pharaohs came into Judea and took 120,000 Jews captive and brought them into Egypt and found out that they could be very helpful. And they ended up getting land grants and thriving in Egypt. You know, this was before Jesus' time. 120,000, and they, a lot of them settled in Alexandria and grew and prospered, and they became very prosperous. And they invited other Jews from Judea and other places, come to Alexandria, it's wonderful here. And so the Jews were immigrating in great numbers to Alexandria and to other places. Antioch was another very nice place. It wasn't as big as Alexandria, but I mean, some estimate as much as 500,000 to 1 million people lived in Antioch, in the greater area. And that was before Rome became a big city, really. In Constantinople, I mean, there was these areas where very cosmopolitan and metropolitan and sumptuous. I mean, Antioch and Alexandria were sumptuous. I kept thinking, oh, these poor people that live in mud huts, you know. No, they did not. No, they did not. They had amenities. They loved amenities. They lived as good a life as possible back then. And if we found ourselves in one of these really upscale places back then, we might look around and say, wow, This is beautiful. I mean, when the Arab conquest, the Islamic conquest of Alexandria happened in 640 something, whatever it happened. I mean, the general came in and he just was astonished. He said, "My God, this seems like the whole place is built of marble." Although Ptolemy's apparently built mostly of limestone, they used marbles for marble and brass for monuments and things like that. But they may have clad a lot of buildings in marble in some of the bigger temples, etc. But the Arab general was, the Islamic general was astonished at this place. The lighthouse of Philo, you know, a 400-foot-high lighthouse at the harbor. 400-foot-high lighthouse. You know, the wonders of the world were there. So he said, "What?" He said, "This place could not have been built by humans. It must have been built by jinn. You know, the spirit, some sort of spirits had to build this place. Humans couldn't have built any such a place that's so beautiful." And this is where the people lived. Antioch wasn't some backwater swamp. I mean, it was laid out by the chief architect of Alexander the Great too, with these, you know, with the hub and the streets in Alexandria. The main street was 200 feet wide, colonnaded the entire way, beautiful colonnades, markets, beautiful shops with luxuries around the world, you know, on the people were not what we thought, I was taught they was at all. These people were smart, they were cosmopolitan, they had coinage, you know, money throughout the realm. People bought and traded in luxuries and ate very, very well from the fruits and granaries throughout the whole empire. They had the big wine and the dates and the fruits and the meat and the beautiful clothing. I mean, they lived luxuriously, a lot of them, if you were wealthy. But even the people that weren't, they lived in the city. The city was a sumptuous city. It was and Antioch was too. Antioch was known for being a beautiful, beautiful, rich, opulent city. Actually, the morals are very lax there. The pagans had this grove of Daphne that was this huge paradise-like park that was set out near Antioch. But it was beautiful, beautiful place. Gorgeous temples and buildings and colonnades and stuff by the Greeks. And you know, the Greek architecture was beautiful. And Alexander, you know, spread that. And the Greeks were very skillful at building very beautiful buildings. And we have a lot of that architecture in the United States. Greco-Roman architecture is, you know, very, very popular. Washington has a lot of Greco-Roman architecture. Well, back then, you know, Alexandria was just a jewel. So I'm thinking, oh, poor Jesus, he's gone down to the desert, and oh my gosh, it's hideous. Now he's living in Alexandria. You know, Joseph maybe been a carpenter there, did construction work or something. That's not a bad place to be, to put it mildly. And then, you know, and the early Christians, well, they're in Antioch, they're in Damascus, they're in Alexandria, they're in Constantinople. They're in Rome, they're in these Ephesus. I mean, these places were gorgeous. And the roads that the Roman, Greco-Roman world were beautiful roads. I mean, holy cow, you saw this road in Antioch. I mean, it's still there, beautiful. They laid down these heavy stones. It was smooth, heavy stones. And the chariots and the transportation of the day moved very smoothly along these, you know, of course you get jostled a little bit, but they did great architectural and engineering works. They had aqueducts bringing water. I mean, the ancient world was extraordinary. Absolutely extraordinary. And so Jesus did not live in some hideous world, really. I mean, I thought it was just dust and desert and hideous. No, he lived in an extraordinary world, extraordinary time. Now, it was all egoic, of course, but people there thought a lot of themselves. They weren't living in some backwater swamp. Alexandria was not a backwater swamp. It was the center of the planet, cosmopolitan center of the planet. And the intellects of the people there were substantial, actually. And the craftsmanship and artisanship was substantial. And they put together, a masterpiece city. So I'm just, stunned by all this information. And the Alexandrian Jews, I mean, were very sophisticated. They had the Septuagint of the, the Torah translated into Koine Greek, which is common Greek. And they had this, so they had the Bible in they spoke Greek. I mean, they're Hellenized Jews in Alexandria. They spoke Greek. They spoke Greek. They were very educated in both in Judaism and in Greco-Rome, Hellenization and in Grecian philosophy and liberal arts and intellectualism. And they were sophisticated people. More sophisticated than many people today. I mean, most people sitting watching television, watching all these psychotic fear, contractual fear programs meant to contract you into fear. They were probably, they probably look at us like, look at these barbarians. These were not what we would call barbarians, actually. These are people of letters. I mean, they wrote. They had the world's greatest library was in Alexandria. Museums, the Greeks instituted museums. Before that, there weren't museums. They installed museums wherever they went, and they were very much into history. And so they would actually were archaeologists. They collected stuff from history and put them in museums. That's where you get these busts and sculptures of they were skilled. They had museums, they had libraries. This massive library is where all the scholars of the world came to study in Alexandria. The intellectuals, the scholars, the philosophers, they came to Alexandria to study in this massive library, intellectual center of the world. So, we're thinking, oh, poor Jesus, where did Jesus go in the lost years? Well, maybe he was in Alexandria. I mean, ships went all the time from Alexandria to Jerusalem. Of course, Jerusalem wasn't a port, so they had to go to some port city and then travel to Jerusalem. And again, there's massive amounts of Alexandrian Jews in to Jerusalem. Jerusalem was seen as the holy city of the central, like the holy city of the Jews. Like, the Greeks, or maybe with the Delphi Oracle or something was the holy place or whatever they had. They had some holy places. But the center of the Jewish world was really Alexandria. That was the center. It wasn't really Jerusalem. That's where the temple sacrifices were carried out. That's where the Jewish law, at the center of the religion. But the cultural, ideological, intellectual center was Alexandria. And I didn't know this. Yeah, I was ignorant of this fact. And so this really rocked my worldview, view of history. It really gives a different perspective and spin on it all. And Christianity didn't start out in what we're taught. Like I thought, like, well, it's just some little farmer, in Galilee, saying some prayer. I don't know. It started out in these super metropolitan centers. The center of the world was Alexandria, just like, of course, a miracle started out from Columbia University in New York. New York's just, you might say, is the center of the world in a lot of ways. Banking, commerce, a lot of different things. New York is a real major hub of the world, right? Some could say it's biggest, most important city in the world. That's, of course, the miracles came out of Columbia University. A couple of, professors there, Helen Schuckman and William Tedford. They're working there. And it came out among New York Jews. What was it, Kenneth Wapniak, and a lot of the people associated with the Course in Miracles were New York Jews. Okay, just as in Christianity came, a lot of it came out of Alexandria, Hellenized Jews from Alexandria, from Antioch, from the Constantinople area, Damascus, Ephesus, Rome. Rome had a very large Jewish population, also very large. And it's amazing. The population of Jews in Alexandria is like right now was Tel Aviv and New York have the highest amount of Jewish population, 3-something million Tel Aviv and 2-something for New York, but Alexandria would be ranked third, right now for Jewish population around the world. So that was the center. And that was an apostolic see. Mark, the evangelist Mark, went to Alexandria. But Alexandria was already the philosophical center of the world for this Greco-Judean synthesis. Philo synthesized, you know, Greek philosophy and Jewish theology, basically said that all Greek theology came from Judaism, from Moses. That's what Philo's position was, that the Greeks stole everything from the Jews, you know, which is, you know, I don't know if that is, can really, that's a tough one to assert. But this was Philo's position, and he would have immense authority and power in Alexandria and the Jewish world. I always thought Jerusalem was the center of everything, but actually not at all. That was not really true. What happened was Jerusalem was based on pilgrimage, that you had to go for these holy, various reasons to, you know, like Mary and Joseph had to go there for ritual purity laws. Mary had to have sacrifice a couple, you know, to purify her, and then they had to pay a tithe of the firstborn son, because, you know, the Jews have said instead of sacrificing their firstborn, whatever, son or daughter for sacrificing, they pay a tithe, and that satisfies God. The temple priest said, yeah, well, God's wrath will be satisfied upon you if you just give a certain amount of money to the temple. So Jews came from all over the great diaspora, all over the whole Greco-Roman Empire. At that time was, you know, it was Greco-Roman, but it used to be mostly Greek Empire. Came to Jerusalem from all these different places. They lived very sumptuous, cosmopolitan places, a lot of them. Some rural agriculture too, and they would go to Jerusalem to pay their money, pay their tithes for their sins, to sacrifice, to get rid of their sins, to satisfy the law. That's, and then they go back to their, like Jesus went to Jerusalem a number of times, right? They didn't live there. Jerusalem's not that big. I mean, the living quarters, they didn't live there. I'm not sure what the population of ancient Jerusalem was, but they didn't live there. So Alexandrian Jews would journey to Jerusalem for various holy, you know, reasons to satisfy the law, and then they go back to Alexandria. So it was a pilgrimage city. It was a pilgrimage city. That's what it really was. Pilgrims coming and going, coming and going, coming and going, coming and going, because the temple there, the sacrificial altar was there. And the priestly class was there, doing the sacrifices, because only they knew what God's wrath demanded, right? God's wrath had told Moses, hey Moses, that, you know, this is what anchors me, and this is what you need to do to pay it off, but I'm going to be more lenient on you, because if you're just very, very dedicated to paying it off correctly, then that will satisfy my wrath. But these others, I got to be more severe with them, because they forget, you know. But if you don't forget, I'm going to go a little more lenient on you. Oh, boy. Anyway, so this is the real story of ancient history. And this is why when the Romans finally destroyed Jerusalem in 130-something A.D., raised the countryside. They raised the countryside, and they renamed Jerusalem Capitolina something. And they forbid, at the penalty of death, any pilgrims, any Jewish pilgrims coming to that, except on Tish B'Av, one day was allowed. But other than that, on the penalty of death, they could not take a pilgrimage to Jerusalem. I think I said that right, Tish B'Av, I'm not sure. But anyway, the day of mourning, one day they're able to do that, but nothing else. So they didn't want any pilgrimages coming to that place anymore at all. Because then when you're on pilgrimage, religious zealotry, the zealots could stir up rebellion, which is what the zealots did. Which was, they wanted Jesus to help them out do that. Is there are certain times where there are millions of people in Jerusalem from all over, and these holy days. Okay, and then the zealots would start circulating among them, and they'd fomenting the attitude of resurrection. Hey, let's rebel against Rome. Let's get it going. Let's rock and roll here. They're taxing us. We hate that. You know, the Jews in Alexandria were not Hellenized. The Greeks in Alexandria had special privilege. Obviously, the population was Egyptian, lived in Egypt. So the Egyptians, once Alexander conquered Egypt, then the Greeks were installed in the top positions. But the Egyptians were still allowed to have a lot of positions, okay? But the Greeks had what's called citizenship, and they had special privileges, especially the law. Everything applied to the Greeks was different. And the Jews didn't have Greek citizenship. They did have high positions, but they didn't have Greek citizenship. Now, when the Greeks, what was it, when the Romans, I think, decided to tax everyone who didn't have Greek citizenship, something like that, there was a Greco-Roman phase, and the Jews were desperate to gain citizenship to avoid all this taxation, etc. And so this is most coveted, and not being able to get this, then they rebelled. And so there was a lot of revolt in Alexandria between the Jews and the Greeks, and a lot of fighting back and forth and slaughter, etc. And so it became a very nasty situation there. That's the history, you know. I mean, the taxation. The Romans levied a tax, very severe tax, if you weren't So to gain citizenship as a Greek was like all important. So Christianity came out of this thought, you know, this synthesis between Judaism and Hellenistic thought, Greek philosophy, was very prevalent then. Philo was very famous and an exponent of this. He was one of the, you know, the big wigs of the library, I believe. There he was very high top position. Actually, he actually was the one chosen to go to Caligula, I believe, and ask for some sort of, you know, for the emperor to reestablish order in Alexandria because the Jews were getting slaughtered. And so he was the one. He was the top dog there. And he was a philosopher, and he's the one that, you know, was... So Christianity started in these places where there was this, this strong Greek philosophy along with the Jewish religion and the synthesis of this. This is where Christianity, the churches were established in these places. These were not, we think here in like America, we think like Protestant churches. They're like a little village out in the Appalachians Mountains. They've got a little church there, a little white steeple. You know, it's so, people are so poor and honest and helpful one another. And this is, you know, the idea that these little Christian churches dotting villages isolated from one another. This wasn't how Christianity was born. Christianity was born like in Alexandria, I mean, in Antioch. Massive, gorgeous synagogues and these great philosophers and intellectuals. The mood of the time was highly intellectual and philosophical. You know, these very brilliant intellects, and they were, ideas were flowing. And this is where Christianity was born. You know, we keep saying, well, it was born in a manger. You know, well, that Jesus may have been, but Christianity, as far as the ideology of it, which led to all these, I mean, Cyril of Alexandria was the one that won the Council of Chalcedon, which is right by Constantinople, which I think was what we call Istanbul now, just across the Straits of Bosphorus from it. That's where the council was held. It was Cyril of Alexandria who was the patriarch of that apostolic see of Alexandria. I mean, they're still top dogs. In that, even then, I mean, Rome was, of course, a top dog also, but Alexandria was still very powerful intellectually and the state of philosophical authority. Okay, and he's the one that pushed the Alexandrian idea against the Nestorian idea of Antioch, and won the day and said that Jesus has these two distinct natures, but the hypostatic union makes them somehow mysteriously, we don't know, understand how it is, but it makes them one without violating the two-ness of it, you know. And this became then the creed, Chalcedonian creed became the creed of Christianity. And this came from Alexandria, which was, you know, the powerhouse, and you have to say the cradle of Christianity has to be said to be Alexandria and Antioch. Those were the two cradles of Christianity, really. And so Mark wasn't going down into some backwater swamp. He was going into Alexandria to speak with these very sophisticated, learned, Hellenized Jews there. Wealthy. Not all of them, but all, the artisans were no, you know, these people were had dignity of their own, didn't they? I mean, these were skilled artisans, merchants and artisans. So, and he would be talking to the rabbis there, etc. You know, and these people were the most significant synagogue in the world. Out, if you don't, you know, as far as the wealth and power. I mean, if you look at Jerusalem, it was the temple. It's a slightly different, it was a different situation. Okay, so Mark was not just evangelizing in the dusty villages of Galilee. He was evangelizing in Alexandria. This is a mind blower. And so the Christians' ideas that established the church in Alexandria, this wasn't some establishing a church in the dusty backroads by Capernaum, by the Sea of Galilee. That's not how it happened. And that didn't happen that way. This was in the heart of the greatest city the world had ever known. And up until recently, it's probably kept that distinction. Alexandria was flat out one of the greatest cities in the history of this planet. Even nowadays, it would rank very highly. It may be up higher than we're willing to admit. This is where Christian ideas, the idea of the Christian church, took root in these places. And of course, the splendors of Rome are very well chronicled. And this is where the Roman Empire gained its greatest strength. This is where ultimately the power got centralized in Rome. So this is where the papacy eventually got its strongest roots. But that wasn't really established. The primacy of that wasn't necessarily something that was. Rome didn't just dictate to everybody. No. Alexandria had the power. Apostolic sees in Alexandria and Antioch had the power, tremendous power. It's the emperor that had the power in Rome saying, hey, you guys work out your troubles. I don't want insurrection in these cities. These ideas are causing a lot of ferment. I don't like that. I want the trade to be uninterrupted. I don't want riots in Alexandria because we want the corn and the grain and whatever. We want that flowing into Rome. Come on. We can't have people burning the docks as Caesar apparently did. And apparently burned some of the library as he set fire to the docks to create a distraction. The fire spread to the library, and some of the problems of burning the library may have occurred at that time. Maybe several phases of destruction of the library. Ultimately, it was completely destroyed. So they said we want things business to run smoothly. So settle your differences. And we'll administer, we'll put the official stamp of the emperor upon whatever agreement you come up with. So the Chalcedonian agreement was that, Jesus, this is Christianity, this is our creed. God, man, two distinct natures in one hypostatic union. Fully man and fully divine. But somehow one that we can't say how. It's just some hypostatic, some union of essence, underlying unity that we don't understand. It just is there. So the emperor said, okay, good. We'll stamp that. This is the creed. And to make sure that it remains the creed, why don't we make Rome, the administrative center of Christianity so that we can make sure that we can administer the empire and Christians from every place agree this is the official creed of the Roman Empire. Because remember, the Roman Empire had adopted Christianity. Constantine had adopted this as official religion because they felt that this was going to help them administratively run their empire properly, better. They liked the attitude of and so they said, we can work with this, and we're going to be able to maintain our empire. So help us. This helps the pagan, pacifies the pagans. We like this. So he said, okay, so Roman Empire is going to say, we're going to minister it from Rome. And we're going to say, this is how all the cities, the whole Roman Empire, we're all going to agree, Christians, this is your creed. Stop fighting among one another. Stop fighting this, fighting. They didn't want all this. There's all this fighting going on. The Roman Empire wanted a unified creed. So they hammered out a unified creed in Chalcedon and Cyril of Alexandria, the great patriarch of Alexandria. His idea about the dualistic nature of Christ, two natures and a hypostatic union, they adopted that, and they said, okay, and the emperor said, boom, rubber stamp, this is it, no more fighting, we don't want any more squabbles, we don't want any more rest, right? We don't want Christian fighting Christian, we want peace, we want prosperity throughout the kingdom, so this is what we're going to go forward with. Papacy is here in Rome, the Pope makes the decisions, and of course the Pope make sure that those decisions are the ones the emperor wants to have made. And we all live happily ever after. Of course, you know, the truth got thrown in the wastebasket. But the emperor didn't really care about that. The emperor didn't care about truth. The emperor cared about commercial prosperity and peace throughout the land. So the Docetism was completely crushed in the first century, which was much closer to the truth of the whole situation. And and then ultimately, you know, Nestorianism was kicked out into, pushed into the Far East areas. This is the ragged-tagged history, which is what really happened. Ragtag history. And so we, you know, just for there to be peace and prosperity, we feel we have to go along with this doctrine. Because this is the Roman Empire, of course, really, even though Rome was sacked and declined in a lot of ways, the administrative and the roads and the administration, everything, it still spread throughout. It ultimately became the Holy Roman Empire in Europe. And, you know, it never really went away. And Christianity held it all together. And the idea was, in order to have peace and prosperity, Christianity is very, very important. And so we've all believed that we need to accept this creed, the basic creeds of Christianity, in order to have this peace and prosperity, in order to have at least this breath to at least consider, you know, peace and prosperity and reason. Let us look at reason more. So it's been helpful in some ways, this creed. Maybe they figured, you know, that in order to stop the squabbling, let's just adopt this dualistic creed, because this is an accommodation that we need for now. Okay, so it's water under the bridge. It happened. Many benefited from it. I certainly have benefited from it. It's a lot better than paganism and the constant tribal warfare and sacrifice and the fear base of that type of life, which is very warrior based, and conquest, attack. You know, it's a restless, impulsive life, a lot of it, and easy to party, easy to take offense. You know, then we have a very pagan culture now. Easy to take offense. This whole culture of easily taking offense is just terrible. It's very pagan. Sophisticated cultures, they don't take offense so easily. They're very slow to take offense. They say, hey, we don't want, they know, I mean, the riots in Alexandria, I mean, they said, last thing we want is more riots. Good grief. Let's just all adopt a creed where they'll just help us all get along here. You know, come on. We don't want these problems. We want things to run smoothly. of course. So sophisticates that are very slow to take offense. They say, there's really very little anyone can do for me to take offense, and even so, we'll adjudicate it through all this legal systems and stuff, and there's, you know, we're not going to, nothing's going to happen for quite some time, and maybe we'll reach some decision 10 years from now or something, but in the meantime, let's status quo, commerce, business. So they don't want a bunch of philosophers philosophizing. They said, this is the creed. Anyone who says anything like this is a heretic, to be banished into the Netherlands, you know, go with Nestor, you know, into Iran or whatever, China, just get lost, stay out of our empire. So if you were a philosopher and say, hey, wait a minute, you know, this creed is, this is gibberish, you know, oop, that's heresy, you're a heretic, we're banishing you from the empire. Now, they didn't necessarily crucify you. I mean, it has been played up, you know, the crucifixions of everybody. That was used occasionally, but a lot of times you were banished from the empire, banished. Get out of our empire. Go in the desert somewhere. Get lost. Stop stirring up the crazy, so to speak. Like, you know, saying, well, Jesus wasn't really dualistic nature. He was really divine, and this was all just a phantom, just an appearance. You know, that's heresy. That'll stir up conflict in the empire. Get lost. We don't care where you go. Just get lost. We don't want to see you around here anymore. It was a lot like that, actually. And there was some Diocletian persecution of Christians. That did happen. There were persecutions. But then the next emperor would come in and say, hey, we, Alexandria is too important. Let's not stir up insurrection there. Let's keep it. It's okay. You know, just keep it on the down low. Don't agitate. And eventually they adopted the creed. So it was a unified Christianity. But, of course, it was, you know, we we think we need to, again, we need to live by that creed and to be good citizens. So yeah, you can be a good citizen too without necessarily believing in that creed. You don't automatically become a bad citizen, and you don't automatically stir up all sorts of conflict either. But this is enough. I can feel my voice. The stress is trying to hit my voice right now. That means I better not say any more. This is enough. This has been plenty to consider. Very difficult to give voice to truth here. It's a sign of overload when this happens. So this is plenty. We're almost done with the video anyway. Right? Yeah. So back from our history lesson here, which is very interesting, but we'll go back to assertions. Remember, please, if you can, if you want that ticket, and everybody does, actually. I already have the ticket. I already received the invitation. I'm in the clear, so to speak. But that doesn't mean I stop working. I work even harder now to try to help others get that ticket also. Go over assertions. Flood your life with assertions. Unapologetic assertions. Unapologetic assertions. Not hostility. Now, I didn't say assertion. Jesus is asserting the truth. You cannot deviate from what you are. I have never deviated from what I am. I have never deviated from the truth of what I am, which is perfection. I have never deviated from the truth of what I am, which is perfection. I have never deviated, and I never can. I can never deviate from truth, and I never can. Truth is true, nothing else is true. I cannot deviate from truth. I have never deviated from truth. I have never deviated from eternal life. I have never deviated from eternal life, and I never can. Flood your life with assertions. This is how you get that ticket. Not through philosophical discussions. You don't get it that way, believe me. I could engage in all sorts of Hellenistic, whatever philosophical discussions, I could engage in those from till the cows come home. I still wouldn't get a ticket. It's the assertions that assert the truth, unapologetically assert the truth. I cannot deviate from what I am, period. I cannot deviate from what God created me as. It's impossible. I cannot deviate from what I am. I cannot deviate from what God created me as. It's impossible. I cannot deviate from my God-created identity. It is absolutely impossible. You know, it's that which works. So, again, I have this. I have a link to the blog site, which I'll try to be posting on more and more. I have a Twitter account, which I'll tweet out when I put something on the blog. I'll tweet it out. I have a Facebook page, which I'll also put that I notice on the Facebook page, which will alert you that there's more tools available for you, more tools of assertion, of unapologetic assertion. I am.